A while back, I made some videos about my criticism of a purely axiomatic application of the non-aggression principle. That video will add some additional context for my stance here, but it's not necessary. Many discussions I have had from you, members of my audience, and elsewhere have turned into the topic of the election. I think it's because there might be one happening. I'm not sure, don't quote me on that. In these discussions, I have run into people who believe quite erroneously that voting is a form of aggression and is never justified. I find this argument far less reasonable and compelling than I have found from other topics within libertarianism where I have a disagreement with a sizable chunk of libertarians. First, I think it's important to talk about the effects of voting, meaning does your vote really matter? It is theoretically possible that you, in an election of 90 million voters, could be the one person who can swing an election. Had you had not voted, the election would have been a tie, and you could see yourself as the one person who made that difference. However, in my opinion, this is far less likely than winning the multi-state lottery. These odds are lowered even more when we talk about presidential tickets in the United States. If you're in a state that's red or blue, your vote matters even less. Even in an election of, say, 1,000 people, it's very unlikely that you would be the deciding vote. There's an argument to be made that while your vote specifically may not matter, that if everybody who voted for the same reason you did heard this argument and decided that their vote didn't matter as well, that candidate would surely lose. So, therein lies a collective meaning in a vote, but your vote specifically, not meaningful. Now, what if you were the one person who was not going to go out and vote, but something made you vote spontaneously? Maybe some news article or some tweet from Donald Trump that made you go out and do it. Well, if the election was decided by one vote, you could see yourself as the one person who swung that election, that very bizarre and unlikely election. But if you lived in that state, I'm pretty sure you would be surrounded by a bunch of other just as unlikely voters than you who went out and voted for that election. Were they less likely to vote than you? Who knows, unless you want to poll every single one of them. So I duck-duck-goed the www.internets.org and asked it, what are the odds of me swinging an election? And it told me depending on what state or districts of Columbia's that I lived in, my odds are anywhere from 1 in 6 million all the way up to 1 in 490 million. So this is all true because this was in a newspaper, so it has to be true. It's not like these journalists have any kind of political axe to grind, right? I mean, how could they? The arguments made by voluntarists say that it is immoral to participate in electoral politics because your vote is the reason why X candidate won, who will, by virtue of their job, inflict acts of aggression on a peaceful people. Moreover, you are tacitly consenting to being governed by participating and playing a part of their charade. Let's tackle the first problem with this argument, the latter part of it. It's interesting that 99.99% of people, not 100%, there's always going to be that weird exception, of people that would make this argument that your vote is a tacit endorsement of being governed, would also make a very compelling case against the concept of a social contract. The idea that, as being a citizen of a particular country, it is implied consent to a certain set of rules enforced by the guns of the state. Tacit consent cannot be accepted as valid, they would say. To quote the great philosopher Lysander Spooner, I didn't sign shit. By the way, he really did say that. In modern American slang and totally not a meme I saw once, but... But how is it, by me living in a country when I have the ability to move if I don't like it, less valid of tacit consent to being governed as me when I...
Pokemon go to the polls!
...and vote for none of the above? And how would me thinking a vote for Joe Jorgensen or Donald Trump as a less dangerous option to Joe Biden be any more consent? There wasn't a box that I signed or a document that I signed that said that I agree that this person is the person I want to govern me and I fully approve of everything the state does. And most people understand that they're not picking the best person for the job, they're just picking the least worst. I don't know many people who believe, including fervent defenders of the state, who would agree that a vote for Joe Biden is endorsement, even more so than the rejection of Trump, let alone an agreement to being governed. The elections are going to happen with or without you. If you're not going to vote in principle or disgust, I have respect for that. However, there will be a person to lord over you, whether 100 people or 10 million people Pokemon go to the polls, and they will not hesitate to point out that they have the will of the American people. You will be governed and you can play the lottery and hope for the best as a defensive strategy. To quote the great and actual Lysander Spooner,
in truth, the case of individuals, their actual voting is not to be taken as proof of consent, even for the time being. On the contrary, it is to be considered that without his consent having even been asked, a man finds himself environed by a government that he cannot resist, a government that forces him to pay money, render service, and forego the exercise of many of his natural rights under the peril of weighty punishments. He sees, too, that other men practice this tyranny over him by the use of the ballot. He sees further that if he will but use the ballot himself, he has some chance of relieving himself from this tyranny of others by subjecting them to his own. In short, he finds himself, without his consent, so situated that if he uses the ballot, he may become a master. If he does not use it, he must become a slave. And he has no other alternative than these two. In self-defense, he attempts the former. His case is analogous to that of a man who has been forced into battle, where he must either kill others or be killed himself. Because to save his own life in battle, a man attempts to take the lives of his opponents, it is not to be inferred that the battle is one of his own choosing. Neither in contests with the ballot, which is a mere substitute for a bullet, because as his only chance of self-preservation, a man uses a ballot, is it to be inferred that the contest is one into which he voluntarily entered, that he voluntarily set up all his natural rights as a stake against those of others to be lost or won by the mere power of numbers. On the contrary, it is to be considered that in an exigency into which he had been forced by others, and in which no other means of self-defense offered, he, as a matter of necessity, used the only one that was left to him.
Thanks, Lysander. Couldn't have said it more gooder myself. Now, let's dive more into the second part of this. To put it more verbosely in a way that makes it a steel man, the argument was that because your action of voting for a candidate who won, you are now complicit in his acts of aggression since he used your ballot as a way to inflict those harms. Had he not gotten your vote, he could have lost or not been sanctioned by you to do those acts. This is analogous to a bank robbery. You were not the one who went into the bank to rob them. You weren't the one who shot the security guard to show them that you were serious. You were not the ones to take the bags of money, nor did you even receive any of the money from the heist. The only thing that you did was drive the robbers from the bank to the meetup. You are a part of the crime, and you have a moral connection to the crime. Now, as we've stated before, your vote is extremely unlikely to win an election unless there's also a great number of other people voting in the same way in the same contest for them to win. Each of them had their own motivations for casting that ballot. Most, at least sane libertarians, would agree that if global warming was some kind of hoax made up by Soros to install Marxism, that the pollution that comes out of your car is not good for the environment. Especially from people who lived from 1970 to the 1990s in a major city, and cutting emissions is a good idea generally so long as it's not some part of a New Deal green crap, right? So does it mean that you as a driver of a car is morally responsible for the damage of the air quality in a major city as this, in the same way that a driver in a bank robbery is? If I was the only person to drive a car in the world, my emissions would not matter. But to put the quality of the whole onto one of the actors is fallacious. The argument that you can hold something that is true against the whole can be applied to its individual parts is called the fallacy of division. All of the cars on the road in LA in the 1990s caused smog alerts. Therefore, me driving to work caused a smog alert. No. As stated before, my car does not have the ability to do that even if I was driving a Hummer 1. And even if I decided to just walk that day, all else being equal, it would still have resulted in a smog alert. Just if I didn't vote for a candidate who won, all else being equal, he would have been elected unless it was that 1 in 1 million freak occurrence that happened. Now, when I made my video on the non-aggression principle, which I'm linking in the description box, and the other YouTube thing, Bob, which you can see only on YouTube here, I had people tell me that small actions that have negative but negligible results aren't really acts of aggression. My smoking on the porch couldn't reasonably be argued that a neighbor could get cancer from it. It's possible, but it's not really. My breathing air wouldn't result in global warming, if true. My light bulb isn't going to sun bleach your house paint enough for it to be considered a violation. However, these arguments get accepted as true in voting by the people who tell me in their next sentence that my vote doesn't matter and will never swing an election. What? So people want to know how I'm going to act in all of this. Did you vote? Am I going to vote? How would I vote? Well, I live in the great state of Nevada, where we get an option to vote for none of the above. When they show the results of the election, they show how many people picked none of the above. I get a kick out of seeing that number get larger, and I want to see it actually win an election one of these days. That'd be great. I know it won't matter, they'll probably just choose the candidate who got the most votes in the end, but it does make me smile. Smile enough so that I'm willing to Pokemon go to the poll.
Pokemon go to the poll!
To make it happen. However, I think that one particular candidate, if he's overwhelmingly worse, and it has to be overwhelmingly worse, I will vote against him. I will. I was already gonna Pokemon go to the poll for my own amusement. And what's the difference between touching one part of the screen versus touching another part of the screen? If my touching the screen is going to be inconsequential at the end of the day. So yes, I'm going to be voting in this election, and I'm going to be touching the box next to Donald Trump. And why not? Nobody's getting hurt by it. Anyways, I will talk to you guys later. Worms.
Pokemon go to the polls.